Hello everyone, welcome to The Imprint, and today we're looking at the Indian Visual Arts CCRT, and this is in the series of our Indian culture videos. Today we're looking at the Rajasthani and the Pahari school of paintings. This basically flourished in the royal courts of Rajputana in northern India in the 17th and 18th century, and they were artisans and artists which were trained in the Mughal miniatures. And they were dispersed from the Mughal court, and they basically developed local traditions of painting. And the most famous one is the Bani Thani, and this is by Nihal Chand. And this basically was patronized by the ruler of Kishangarh at that time. And the reason is that if you think about him, so the themes of Rajasthani paintings are very, very, I would say, romantic in nature. Right, and Nihal Chand, who lived from 1710 to 1782, was a chief painter at the Kishangarh, where Sawant Singh, who was also known as Nagari Das, made him depict his mistress Bani Thani, and also depicted him as Krishna and his mistress as Radha. Right, and that is obviously one of the most famous examples of Rajasthani school. So let's go into detail now. I would say that. So the Central Indian Rajasthani schools, right, that is 17th to the 19th century. So unlike the Mughal painting, which is primarily secular, the art of painting in Central India and Rajasthani and Pahari region is deeply rooted in Indian traditions. So taking inspirations from Indian epics, religious texts like the Puranas, love poems in the Gita Govinda, Mewar, Rajasthani school of painting, Sanskrit and other Indian religions. There's a cult of Vaishnavism, Shaivism, and Shakti, and that actually has very, very strong influence on the pictorial art. Okay, so there are themes of Krishna, his gopis, and that theme is very, very prevalent. So you can see here, right? There are themes of the Ramayana, the Mahabharata, the Bhagavata, the Shiva Purana, the Naishadhip Charita, the Usha Aniruddha, the Gita Govinda of Jayadeva, the Rasamanjari of Bhanudatta, the Amaru Sartaka, the Rasika Priya of Kevadasa, the Bihari Satyasi, and the Ragamala, which has obviously provided a very rich field to the paintings. Now, the Rajasthani school actually is basically comprised of Mughal artists of inferior merit. And they were, if you don't get employment with the Mughal emperors, you go to local courts. And here you see the theme. This is Ravana and Sita. So this theme is very, very prevalent. Then obviously, Krishna and his mistresses, that theme is obviously there in the gopis, the romanticism. So the Rajasthani style of paintings include that of Mewar, and it is basically marked by bold drawing. So it's very bold. And there's contrast. So there is, look at the contrast here. So if you think about it, it's yellow and black. So it's very huge contrast, I would say. Okay. Krishna is depicted as blue, right? In some of them, he's depicted as a black, is a darker color, right? I would say not exactly a black, but a darker color. Now, Mughal influence is seen in the refinement of the drawing, and some elements of naturalism is there. And there's a distinct facial type, costume, and landscape. So you'll feel that every school has a different facial type, I would say. Okay, so let's look at the Malwa school. So important paintings in the Malwa style are a series of paintings from the Rasika Priya, that is 1634, and a series of Amaru Sataka, this is painted in 1652 at a place called Nasratgarh. And then the Ragamala paintings, obviously by Madhav Das, right at Nars Yagnasha. So what is so different? So, these things can be asked in your exam. So, Mala paintings show a fondness of rigorous flat compositions, black and chocolate background. So, look at this chocolate background is there. Okay. So, if you see a chocolate background, recognize this quickly to be Mala. Then it is shown against a solid color patch, and architecture is painted in a lively color. Okay. So, they're, bright colors, right? Look at the white and all that. Obviously, there is a primitive charm and a childlike vision, right? It's very simple, the painting. There's not too much complications. There is a peacock here, you can see, right? And there's, if you look at the whiteness, right? So architecture is lively. It's white normally, as you see in Malwa. The Mewar school. So the Mewar school is a little different, I would say. So the earliest example is the Ragamala painting in 605. So what are Ragamala paintings? They're basically paintings of the Hindu ragas, right? So basically different type of rag, the rag Deepak, etc., Hindola rag, and so on. So this was done at Chavand, at a small place in Udaipur, by Misardi. Example obviously also is by Sahibuddin in 1628. It is there in the National Museum. And there's also the Lalita Ragini. So this is the Lalita Ragini. The heroine, you can see, is lying on a bed and with the eyes closed, with a maid pressing her feet. The hero is carrying a garland and is seen in either hand, and the foreground also, the groom is sitting near the steps of a pavilion. So there's love scenes, a lot of love scenes. There's what a person experiences in real life, I would say. Now if you look at the Bundi school, right, it is very close to the Mewar style, but the former excels in later in quality, I would say. Bundi school, 1625, Bhairavi Ragini and the Rasika Priya obviously are the famous examples. The peculiar colors are rich and glowing. There is the rising sun in golden color, in the crimson red horizon is shown, overlapping semi-naturalistic trees, I would say. Still naturalistic, but semi-naturalistic. Mughal influence is there in the drawing of faces, and there's an element of naturalism, right, which is m not there in other schools. There's a lot of exaggeration, I would say, in other schools. So the Kota school, right, there's a style of painting which is very similar. So look at Krishna being depicted in a darker tone here. There's a theme of tiger and bear hunt, which is very similar to the Mughal paintings. Kota paintings, obviously, the space is occupied by hilly jungle, which is obviously the area around Kota, right, which was the hunting grounds at that time. Amber and Jaipur style of paintings, obviously, they have very close relationship with the Mughals. So obviously, the paintings are very similar. There's a large number of portraits, okay, and miniatures, which can be assigned to the Jaipur school, I would say. But the themes are still, a lot of themes from Krishna's life, right? Krishna, if anybody's watching Sri Krishna these days on Doordarshan during COVID, I think you can actually imagine, a lot of themes from that are there. But if you think about what is the foundation of, the Rajasthani school, it is the Mewar school. And it's the earliest example. Why? Because Mewar was captured the last, right, by the Mughals. So 1623, there's an artist named Birji, and he painted the Ragmala. The miniatures obviously are primitive and vigorous. They are not influenced by the Mughal style, unlike the others. Then we have Bikaner style, which is obviously, there's some patronage, right, by the Mughals there as well. But the most interesting, I would say, the most amazing, we talked about the Bani Sani before as well. So the Kishangarh school, right? And there's a Kishangarh motif also. There's a different way the eyes are portrayed in the Kishangarh motif. So during the second quarter of the 18th century, there developed the most charming school of Rajasthani painting in Kishangarh. And this is Raja Sawant Singh, who was a great patron. He himself wrote devotional poetry. He assumed the name of Nagari Das. He, even with his mistress, when the ending of his life, went to the birthplace of Krishna, in Vrindavan, and lived there. A small number of Kishangarh miniatures are available, most of them obviously by Nihal Chand, and the idea was to create visual images of his master's lyrical composition. The artists have obviously exuded human different type of human figures, delicately drawn. I think these are the ones. So this is Krishna playing holy. So look at the eyes. This kind of tells you this is the Kishangarh motif. This is again Krishna on a boat. This is basically he in the Raja Sawant Singh being depicted as Krishna. And then this is the other, this is, the king, and this is his mistress. So that is what the, his major of his paintings were. So the paintings are drawn by delicate drawing, as you can see. There's fine modeling of the human figures, cows, and obviously broad vista of the landscape showing, streams, rows, overlapping trees and architecture. The artist has displayed a masterly skill, right, in drawing these miniatures. The paintings have a golden inner boundary as well, and most of them are by Nihal Chand, I would say. So look at this golden inner boundary here if you want to. And there's a lot of landscape which is being shown. Look at the landscape being shown here. Okay, look at the landscape being shown here. Okay, so obviously Krishna cannot be playing holi in Rajasthan, but that is what is being depicted. So he is Krishna, that is the king and the Raja, and this is his mistress playing with her. Now, From this, I think we should move to the Pahari school. And the Pahari school obviously comprised of the present state of Himachal. And the Basoli school obviously is the most famous. It's under the patronage of Raja Kripal, Kripal Pal. And there's an artist named Devi Dasa who basically made the Rasa Manjari illustrations. And the Rasa Manjari illustrations are painted in the same way. Right, and they're also there in Indian and foreign museums. The Basoli style basically has a lot of vigor. There's sort of bold lines and glowing colors are there, right, as you can see here. And Basoli style obviously spread to the others. So Basoli style has very strong contrasting colors, monochrome background, large eyes, bold drawing. There's a use of beetle wings. So this kind of question, objective type question, can be asked that, you know, where beetle wings were used to, in the Basoli style they were used. There's narrow sky, there's red border and so on. Now, the Gulen school obviously is from Jammu, right? And these basically are portraits. So this is a portrait of Raja Balwant Singh of Jasrota. And this was done by Nainsukh, who originally belonged to Guler and then went to Jasrota. The paintings are new naturalistic. So, there's a delicate style marking a change from the earlier tradition of Basoli art. Now, very interestingly, look at the king killing a cow. Now, this kind of tells you that, what is seen as to be a taboo today might not have been a taboo at that time. Okay. Right. Those colors are soft and cool, as you can see. Right. The style has been inspired by the Mughal naturalistic style of Muhammad Shah period. So the Kangra school of painting, right? Obviously, the Guler style was followed by another style of painting named the Kangra style, representing the third phase of Pahari painting in the last quarter of the 18th century. The Kangra style is developed out of the Guler style. It has delicacy of drawing. So look at the drawings are beautiful in the Kangra style. And obviously, they are identical to the style of Raja Sansarchand of Kangra. And these paintings, there's a nose is always in line with the forehead, the eyes are long and narrow, and the chin is sharp. There's no modeling of, faces. The hair is treated as a flat mask, which is not was not the case, in other paintings. Let's if you say look at the Mughals. Then we have the Kullu and the Mandi. So look at this is, Krishna, one of the most famous stories of Krishna picking up the Govardhan Parvat. So along with the naturalistic Kangra style in the Pahari region, there also flourished a folk style of painting in the Kullu Mandi region. And this is inspired by the local tradition. And this style is marked by bold drawing and use of dark, dull colors. And though the influence of the Kangra style is observed in certain cases, right, there's distinctive focus character. And the miniatures obviously are there, they're portraits, right, obviously. That tends to happen with a lot of the style of painting. There are a lot of portraits of the kings of those times. Now, we like to talk about Nainsukh, who was an Indian painter and was the younger son of Pandit Sedu and his older brother Manaku. They were the most important practitioners of Pahari paintings. And he's perhaps the most original and the brilliant of all. He adapted elements in the Mughal painting. So, if you look at these paintings, these seem Mughal, but very simplistic, I would say. Right. So he brought Mughal elements into what a school was basically of Hindu religious subjects. So that was, I would say, Nainsukh's biggest contribution to these paintings. There is another surviving example of miniature paintings from Odisha. And this is the Odisha school. And obviously, these are from the period of a court scene, so, and illustrated manuscripts of the Gita Govinda. And the Odisha, the palm leaf, obviously continued up till the 19th century. You can think of them as a continuation of the Pala, paintings, but the themes have changed, I would say. Right? There, obviously, outline of drawing was rendered on a palm leaf, and then charcoal or ink was rubbed on the drawing. A few colors were used to fill in the drawing there. Right, so charcoal being used is something different. Then early manuscripts obviously have a neatness in drawing, and but in time, the later actually the line becomes bold, a little crude, and obviously the style is ornamental and decorative, I would say. So, this is something to be drawn in your houses or put right like that as a showpiece, I would say. So, what about the technique of these paintings? So, the paintings were executed in the traditional tempera technique. So after first mixing the colors along with the binding medium, they were applied on the drawing. first the sketch was freely drawn in red or black, over which a white priming was given. Then the surface was thoroughly burnished till the outline was clearly shown. Then the second outline was drawn. The first background was colored, and then the sky, building, trees, etc. And the figures was painted last. So basically, what happened? The figure came last, so they had some kind of an effect that the figures looked a lot more brighter than the others. Copies obviously were made of these sketches by rubbing charcoal powder. The dotted outline took place the first, place of the first drawing. Colors obviously were obviously indigo was got from vegetable color. There was lac dye. There was red carmine, which was obtained from insects. Burnt conch shell, zinc, white was used as white color. Lamp black or burnt ivory kajal was used as black color. There was geru, which is red ochre, red lead sindhura. Lac dye and red carmine, obviously, if you want a different kind of red. Then indigo and ultramarine was used for blue, right? And yellow ochre and ornament and pori, right? Which was even extracted from the urine of cows fed on mango leaves for use for yellow. So this was used for painting yellow. Now, silver and gold also were used. Then there was others like tarabite, malachite, but that is were used as green color, right? So gum and Arabic neem was used in binding media in colors. Brushes were made of animal hair. Fine brushes, obviously, these days, I think we use brushes made of mongoose hair, which is obviously has a problem, right? But at that time, squirrel hair was used. Apart from palm leaf and paper, wood cloth was often used as a material for painting. The traditional, obviously, painting started deteriorating after the 18th, and then we obviously in the next series we'll talk about the company paintings, right, and the modern painting, both Amrita Shergill and the others, the Degos, I would say. So under the impact of Western colors, the technique, the traditional styles kind of died out because the patronage ended. Now, at the end of it, I think this is a question I think you can also try for your mains. So the question is, discuss the importance of the Pahari school of painting as a significant part of India's cultural heritage. In this context, throw light on the Kanga style. So just a rough answer from us, the Pahari school painting obviously developed independently. So how would you like to go about this answer? So you'll talk about, okay, what are the types? So obviously Bansoli and the lyrical Kangra. So talk about the fact there's some influence of Rajasthani and depicting the legends of Krishna. Talk about the Ragamala series on the Gita. So basic idea is talk about the themes here, right? Here, the idea behind, so after you give the introduction, right, we talk about the themes of these paintings. Then you can talk about what kind of colors were used, if there's any difference. So talk about the beetle thing, right? I would think that's something there. Then painting for Gular Hapcham and obviously Gita Govinda, etc. is there. Then Nensuk, you can talk about it, right? Then obviously Kangra style, you can talk about patronized by obviously Raja Govardhan Chand of Guler and then Sansar Chand of Kangra, who were the painters, Manak, Densuk and Pandit Sev. Themes, obviously, we talked about features, right? No, and then the women have noses almost in line of forehead and the eyes are narrow and the chin is sharp. And obviously in the Kangra, obviously, is the art of the line and there's delicacy. There's color and the colors are used of vegetable and mineral extract. So these kind of things you can end. And the end of the talk about the influence which still exists. So right. So remember when you're talking writing an answer in culture, talk about how the Pahari school started. So how the Rajasthani school of painting influenced the Pahari school. And plus, if you think about the themes, the naturalistic themes, so, the Himalayas are very, very beautiful. So the Pahari school also depicts a lot of nature, which obviously we have not really covered here, but there's a lot of nature in Pahari school. So that is how has been depicted. And, after that, talk about the themes and then end with the fact that there's still influence there. If you go to, houses in Himachal, there's still influence of the cultural heritage of the Pahari school. With that, I leave you and thank you so much for listening. Do subscribe to our channel. If you have any questions, you can call us or you can go to our website or email us any questions you might. Thank you so much for listening. I hope you like this series. Thank you so much.